talked about something which I hope someone like me, who is not a domain expert, can add as well. And I'm going to see if I can connect this to observations that I have made in solving other public problems. Now, happy children are often similar, but every unhappy child is unhappy in her own way, in a different way. And many of you recognize the similarity of these sentiments to those stories. I'm not telling you, which says that every happy family is very similar, and unhappy families are unhappy in their own way. And I want to tell a story. When I, for a while, for about 6 months or 7 months, in 2000, I lived in a small town in southern Virginia, and it was a town of a few hundred people. I didn't know anybody there, and I quickly got out. But while I was there, I said I must occupy myself with something to do that is useful besides the job that I was doing. I discovered this organization called the Big Brothers of America. Some of you know Big Brothers. It's an organization that helps connect children without fathers, without adult male figures in their lives, to theoretically responsible adults. So I said, I can do that. And I applied to be a Big Brother for some time. And eventually, after some amount of time, the program matched me to a child. His name is Neil, and I went to his school, and I was introduced to the child, and we spoke for a while. It was clear that it was not just awkward, it was clear that neither of us knew what was supposed to happen in a situation. I was supposed to help him, but I didn't even know what help meant at that time, so it was not clear how to help him. So I said, I'm just going to talk to him for a while and try to understand and learn where he's coming from, what he's about to do. And we spoke for a while. For the first few days, we were only speaking and nothing much happened. And then, in the course of speaking to him in the first week, I asked him, Neil, are you happy? He said, no, I'm not happy. Well, it's pretty good. I actually got him to tell me something that was useful information, data. And I asked him, why are you not happy? He said, all the children in my class know more than I do. And I said, well, that's an interesting problem. That's a problem I can fix, because I know more than those children. And I can teach you something. And so I taught him speed math, how to multiply 2- and 3-digit numbers in your head without a pen or a pencil. That's the kind of stuff that I had as a kid. And so, and then the following week, his teacher came up to me. And he said, what did you tell me? And he didn't tell him anything. I thought, I know very few things, and I taught him one of those things. And he said, he was so enthusiastic in the class today. He was participating in everything. He was first up to respond to the questions that people were, that I was asking. I felt pretty good about it. It's sort of half a beginning as it were. And then we took that as an exercise. And I said, you know, from now on, I'm not going to tell you good morning. I'm not going to tell you good morning. Instead, when I see you, I'm going to say, what I know will make me feel better. And you're going to reply by saying, what I know makes me feel better. And my only goal here is to get you to know more and more things. How do you use them? We'll see about that later. It's going to be no more things. There's no reason why you can't learn more things. So it was a half, in hindsight, it was a half date, and probably an intuitive effort from the beginning. But for a while, it was educational to me. I spoke to him, I thought, and the school was also happy. The school sort of introduced me to a few other children to do some more things with them. And then I had to go away for a few weeks, and when I came back, Neil was not there in the school. There was some problem in the house. Child services had taken the child out of the school and put him in some other school district where the foster home was taken care of. And for the first time, it sort of struck me that in addition to all the problems of feeling good about himself and learning and all the things that he was going through, he also had to confront a reality. He was not in control of his life. It was not his fault that he didn't have a father. It was not his fault that his mother kept getting into any kind of trouble and he suddenly found himself with some new family that he had never discovered. But that's how children are encountering each of the problems that we go through. And I say that each child is unhappy in their own way. There was some years ago, there was another situation. There was an elderly lady who was my neighbor in Greenbelt, just outside of Washington, D.C. And she was in a wheelchair. Her brother was a prostitute. It was unfortunate, but that's what she was. Her brother was a prostitute, and she would often get picked up by the police. And she had two children. And those kids were 4 and 7. And those kids would have all kinds of problems at school, and one day the grandmother asked me, can you take them to school? And it was kind of an unusual request. I'm her neighbor, I really don't know them well, I'm not sure what I'm letting myself get into. But it, again, it was another reminder that from the child's point of view, from the children's point of view, all this is a world that is happening around them, on which they have no control. They are just being buffeted from one thing to another and put in situations where they have to cope with these things. And somehow we as adults have to build a kind of order around that which protects and prevents some of these things from happening. The problem is granular. Yesterday in one of the presentations, somebody was talking about how someone from the community being present at the gate of a school where children were let go from at the end of the day's schooling, that was necessary to ensure that drug peddlers didn't have access to the children. It's granular at that level. You need that outside every single school. And what that means is that you have to increase the number of problem-solving people hugely. We think of police, we think of doctors, we think of psychiatrists, we think of health workers and care providers, all sorts of people as providing help. But all of them together constitute only a small number of the people needed to solve a problem like this. We need to dramatically increase the number of problems solving people, and that's really the challenge. How are we going to increase the number of problems solving people? These people need to do many things. These people need to prevent harm, they need to protect children from harm, they need to redress harm when it occurs. They need to do all sorts of things. Some people who need to do these things need skill and expertise. Some people need skill and expertise. If you're a doctor, it's useful if you're skillful. If you're a child care provider, it's useful if you're skillful. And therefore, we try in places like this, in institutions of learning, in various ways, to increase how much skillful people know, and we try to increase the number of skillful people. That's what we do. We try to do as part of the response. But, and we keep validating this. We had a discussion yesterday about what's working and what's not working. I don't know what is saying. We must not put a hole back in the punches. And if some things are not working, we just don't call them out. And I think that's good. We all learn from things that work and from things that don't work as well. And I think it has built capacity in many, many countries over time. But here's the second problem. The very large number of people that we need, they need to be skillful without expertise. The doctors and the care providers and all these other people, they need to be skillful with expertise. There's a mechanism in place for them to acquire that expertise. But the ordinary citizen standing at the gate trying to prevent some harm from happening to a child, what is the skill he needs? And who's going to teach him that skill? And if we need 2.5 million such people to cover every school in the country, who is going to teach 2.5 million people to be skillful without experience? And these are important, and not just experience, they're not paid for it, they have to show up all the time. They have to trust each other. So it's the problem. I want to identify the nature of the problem at the first stage. We have to dramatically increase the number of problem-solving people. A very large fraction of those people need to be skillful without experience. And these are both very large hurdles to overcome. It's not about knowing what the right thing to do. It's about being able to do that in scale, the kind of scale that is required in every community. But a lot of the time, this skill exists not in each one of us individually, but in all of us together. Some years ago in Bangalore, we decided, about 15 years ago, and so we decided to build a traffic control, a single sort of office, a control center, from which you could watch every intersection with a camera. You could take pictures of vehicles and issue them tickets. You could measure the speeds at which vehicles were moving. You could control the infrastructure. You could turn on and off signals. You could reset the batteries, all sorts of things. When it was first proposed, and I was in the committee that was sort of overseeing all this, and when it was first proposed, people said, okay, we should build this up, and we should find some technology consulting company that can do this. Maybe an Accenture, maybe an Infosys, some company that can do this and can put a system integrator. And I said, why can't the police do this? And the traffic police, why can't they do this? And the response from the public administration was, are you kidding? Have you seen our constables? Have you seen our inspectors? They can't do this. This is not what they're doing. This is not their job. And I said, yes, but it would be useful for them to know these other things as well. And what is it at the end of the day? It's buying a bunch of devices and making them work together. How hard can that be? And in Bangalore, it really shouldn't be hard. This is an IT city, it's a technology city. There are so many people in this city who know how to do this thing. Why on earth would you contract for this? Why don't you just ask people to help? We'll buy the devices, we'll ask people to help, make it all work together. And the commissioner at that point said, I don't think it can work. If you go to somebody and say, we need their help, but there's nothing in it for them, but they just need help. I'll give you an example. We went to Cisco. And we went to Cisco and we said, we need something called a level 3 switch. Which I still don't know what it means, even after having used it for years. It's basically something that controls how various pieces of equipment talk to each other. So we need a level 3 switch. We need you to bring that to our control center and put it there. Make all this equipment connected nicely, make it work together. And then we'll try it for about 6 months. And if it turns out to be the right thing, then we'll put out a bid for buying it. You too can participate in that bid. And if you are selected, we will pay you for this thing. Otherwise, we will return your equipment to the thank you and buy it from whoever is selected. And a lot of people in the committee said, well, no one would help in such a way. And if you said that, the company would say, well, at least give us the chance to eventually become the contractor. We help you. But only in that way. And I said, no, actually, people will help. You need to go tell them all the things that you need. We need a level of research. We need to make it work for a few months. We need to test how it works. We need to test, and you need to train our people in how they work with it. We need to do all these things. And we may not eventually buy this from you. But if you added one more thing, people will have. And the thing you need to add is to say, please do it. It will be good for the city. And that's important. We have reduced ourselves to thinking that other people are atomized individuals looking out for yourself, first and foremost. Until you get that step, then you can't actually bank on asking an intervener what an open school. The individualization of our society is now working against collective efforts that are needed for the protection of our children. That's the way forward. Therefore, when you increase the number of problem-solving people in a deliberate way, you are also signaling to more and more people that every child is your child. It's an age-old problem. It's been known since the time of Plato. But we care more about our children because we know which children are our children. But in a way, we have to create a society in which people care about every child. Enhancing each other's gifts and talents is the way to do it. The answer does exist among ourselves in communities. Celebrating responsibilities. Some years ago, there was a lady who lived in my neighborhood started cleaning all the public parks and lakes and stuff. And she was always looking for volunteers. And she thought, I'm saying, why don't you do it? It's a good thing to improve our neighborhood, so on and so forth. And hardly anybody would come up to help. And then one day we had an idea. There was a Republic Day or Independence Day event. And we made her the chief guest for that event. And had a big celebration acknowledging the work she'd done in the community and so forth. The celebration of her work in front of a very large community made a lot of other people come forward to talk to her to say, how can we help? Now, you could, I don't know whether that is a kind of story of advertising, I don't know. But in some way, it works. For many years, I used to conduct a forum called, it was basically to recognize people in the city who have done something good for the city and to recognize them. It was an annual awards function. The first year that they launched it, we got 76,000 nominations. People saying, this person lives in my neighborhood, he or she has done something good, they should be recognized. There is potential in celebrating responsibility and using that as a way to build the collective that we need. Yesterday, I noticed one thing. In a number of different talks, there were examples of things that appear to be working. VENDA is working. There was another called Listen First, which seemed to be working. And I remember Kalika also saying that listening to the children is something that works. There was another that was referred to called Strong Families, which appears to be working as well. Can we find ways in which multiple things that are working can be applied together in the same geography? And can we build that, can we turn that into the model for intervention? Because in each of our efforts, we are finding that as we do something, one other piece is missing. Therefore, it's not enough to do what we do in our programmatic way. Because the problem is societal, the scale of our response also has to be societal. And that's really the piece that appears to be missing. And if the problem, if the scale of our response is societal, we can get even our elected representatives and public administrators to pay more attention. Otherwise, there are tendencies to stay away from anything that looks complex. So I'll stop there. These are just my ruminations, as it were, of things that I observed yesterday and the possibilities for how to construct our collectives for action in a different way by saying that the problem has its nature. We need to increase the number of problem solving people dramatically. Most of those people have to be able to act without expertise. But that expertise collectively exists in society, and harnessing that expertise across all of society is the way to respond to the problem. And if we harness expertise across all of society, we will be able to carry out many, many programs together in the same place.